Church Union Movements in India. First, we study about the Church of South India or CSI. When the Church of South India was inaugurated on 27th September 1947, it was acclaimed as the most significant event in the Church Union Movement because this is the first time after centuries of historic divisions. Churches with episcopal and non-episcopal ministers were brought together in a united episcopal church. Four different church traditions had been brought together in the CSI. First one is Anglican, they were episcopal, then Congregational, Presbyterian and Methodist. All these churches had been established in India through the missionary work of churches in Europe, America and Australia, who had started their work in India at different periods from the beginning of the 18th century. The Anglican Church was established through the work of the Church Missionary Society, CMS, and the Society for the Propagation of the Gospel, SPG, both closely linked with the Church of England. The congregational churches were established through the missionary activities of the London Missionary Society with missionaries from Great Britain and Australia and the American Board of Commissioners of Foreign Missions, ABCFM. The Presbyterian churches, through the work of Church of Scotland Mission, the Dutch Reformed Church in America and the Basel Mission in Switzerland and Germany. They also had connections with the Presbyterian churches in England and Australia. The Methodist Church was established by the Methodist Missionary Society of the Methodist Church in Great Britain. With the growth of nationalism during the later part of the 19th century, there developed among Indian Christians also a concern for self-reliance and independence. We all know that by the end of the 19th century, the spirit of nationalism was increased in India. And all these churches were established by the Western missionaries and controlled by the Westerners in India. And the people of India, or the Christians in India, with the spirit of nationalism, thought of having an Indian church, a church of church which is originated in India, and also they wanted to come out from the Western rule over their churches. And again, there was further the growing awareness that the divisions among the churches in India were not the making of Christians in India, but brought by the different missions from abroad. Though they belong to different church traditions, they are different not because there was any problem between them, but because of the missions that came here and established churches. Several efforts were made to bring about a united indigenous Christian church in India, free from independence of denominational links with churches in the West. None of these had lasting result. Many efforts were there to have a united indigenous Christian church in India, free from dependence on denominational links with churches in the West. But none of these efforts had lasting results. However, faced with the challenge of the mission frontier and the necessity of better credibility, the churches themselves began to be increasingly aware of the scandal of disunity and sought ways of overcoming it. As a result, different kinds of mergers or unions among churches were beginning to take place. In October 1901, a federal union took place between the Presbyterian missions in South India, the United Free Church of Scotland Mission, the American Arcot Mission of the American Dutch Reformed Church and the Basel Mission. In 1904, the Congregational Churches of the London Missionary Society in South India and the Congregational Churches of the American Board Missions in South India and Jaffna came together in a federal union. In 1908, these two bodies, the Presbyterian and the Congregational, came together to form the South India United Church, SIUC, which is still continuing in some parts of South India. Following the International Missionary Conference held at Edinburgh in 1910, there was even greater impetus for cooperation and union among churches. One of the direct consequences in India of the Edinburgh Conference was the formation of the National Missionary Council in 1914, which later became the National Christian Council of the Churches, that means NCCC. The National Missionary Council organized regional Christian councils. One of the objectives of the regional Christian councils was the strengthening of the evangelistic outreach as a joint or cooperative activity of all the churches. The experience of such joint evangelistic programs of the Madras Regional Council led the churches to raise the question afresh as to whether there was any valid reason for the churches to remain divided when they had the same gospel of Jesus Christ to proclaim in their evangelistic mission. As a result of this realization, an informal meeting of pastors of the Lutheran, Methodist, South Indian United Church and Anglican churches convened by the Reverend V.S. Asaria, later he became the Bishop of Dornacle Diocese, and the Reverend V. Santiago took place at Trancobar. This conference issued a call for union among the churches and a joint committee was set up for considering negotiations for union. The Lutherans did not join this committee, and only the other churches, the Anglicans, the Methodists and the SIUC, participated in the negotiations, which followed. The first meeting of this committee was held in 1920, and following it many meetings were held to consider different issues until the churches could agree on a common basis for union. Quite early in the negotiations, it was agreed that the Lambeth Quadrilateral could be a satisfactory basis for the union of the churches. Lambeth Quadrilateral means if all the churches agree in four issues, then we can become one church. This means that the four basic principles that all the churches have to agree. So these are the four principles. The first one, the Holy Scripture of the Old and New Testament as containing all things necessary to salvation and as the supreme and decisive standard of faith. Second, two creeds, the Apostolic Creed and the Nicene Creed, as witnessing to and safeguarding the faith. Third, the two sacraments of baptism and the Lord's Supper. And the fourth one, the ordained ministry with the historic episcopate. The first three could be accepted without any controversial question. But the fourth became problematic because of the fact that while the Anglican Church had the historic episcopate and all its ministers were ordained by the episcopal laying on of hands, the other churches in the negotiations did not have an episcopalian ordained ministry. Finally, an agreement was reached that insofar as God had blessed all the ministers with undistinguishing regard, all who were already ordained in any of the uniting churches would be received as ministers in the United Church, and that all new ordinations would be by episcopal laying on of hands. It took about 20 years to reach the agreement. It took a few more years for the churches to take their formal decisions accepting the scheme of union. The Methodists gave their vote in 1941. In 1945, the General Council of the Church of India, Burma and Ceylon, they were the Anglicans, gave their consent for the four Anglican dioceses in South India to go into the Union. In 1946, the General Assembly of the South India United Church decided to accept the scheme. These decisions made it possible for the Church of South India to be inaugurated on 27th September 1947. Now, Church of North India, the series of consultations with a view to church union in North India began in 1929. Eventually, on the basis of negotiations, prepared by a series of round table conferences, round table conference means all the participants are equal, a plan of church union was drawn up. A negotiation committee was constituted in 1951 by the church bodies concerned, which were the United Church of North India, the Church of India, Pakistan, Burma and Ceylon, then the Methodist Church in Southern Asia and the Council of the Baptist Churches in Northern India. In 1957, the Church of the Brethren and the Disciples of Christ also joined in the negotiations. The plan reached its fourth and final edition in 1965, and on that basis, the church union in North India was inaugurated on 29 November 1970 in Nagpur. At the last moment, the Methodist Church in Southern Asia decided not to join the union. However, the Methodist Church, the British and the Australasian have joined the union. We can have an evaluation of the church union movement. The concern for unity of the church grew out of a zeal for the mission of the church, because a divided church could not bear witness to the one gospel and one Lord in a country like India, where diverse religions, languages, races and cultures. Through the process of negotiations and prayerful seeking of the guidance of Holy Spirit, unity was achieved in the understanding and practice of the sacraments of baptism and the Lord's Supper. The threefold ministry of bishops, presbyters and deacons, and in the organizational structures of pastorates, dioceses and the synod, episcopacy was received and accepted as both constitutional and historic. Provision has been made for diverse liturgical practices and understanding of the divine revelation, provided that these do not violate the basic faith and order of the church or disrupt the unity and fellowship within the church. Thank you.